Hello everyone, my name is Luis Paez. I'm an undergraduate student in biochemistry. I'm working in Dr. Kettle's lab from the Department of Chemistry and Chemical Biology, and I'm part of the Puente Fellowship, which is sponsored by Centro de la Raza. Today I'm going to talk about coarse grain model of binding between DNA and DNA polymerase, which is the work I have been doing for the last year. So before I get into the question of my research, I want to introduce to the topic of my research, which is based on DNA molecule. So DNA molecule, it's a polymer of nucleic acids. What this means is that it's a molecule made of many repetitive subunits. So think of DNA as a chain, and each of the linkages of this chain is going to be a nucleic acid. And nucleic acids are very similar to each other. They have a phosphate group, a deoxyribose sugar, but the important thing about nucleic acids is that they have a nitrogenous base, and this is actually what makes them different. They can have a nitrogenous base based on adenine, guanine, cytosine, and thymine. And DNA is an informational molecule because depending on the sequence of how these nucleotides are in the molecule, they're going to convey a different message than another one. So DNA by itself is not that cool, actually. DNA needs to have a lot of stuff around it to work, and that's what molecular machinery does. DNA by itself is like a magnetic tape for a movie, if you think in that way, which, yeah, has all the information for the movie, but it needs a lot of machinery to make it reproduce. There is machinery in the cell, that conveys this message from DNA to proteins, and proteins are finally what express the characteristics of the cell. So I'm going to talk today about a DNA, about a machinery specific to the cell called DNA polymerase. And this machinery is in charge of doing DNA synthesis. So if you see right here, DNA polymerase is the yellow bubble that is going from left to right and right to left in the top. And it's basically adding a nucleoside triose phosphate, which are these small subunits floating around the cell. And it's basically stapling one of these to the growing strand, which is DNA. Something important to mention is that from one DNA molecule, from one double helix DNA molecule, two double helix DNA molecules are produced, which are identical. Hopefully, there are no mutations to the parent strand. So this is how it looks like in the cell. Can you put that, please? Yeah, so this is a video of how DNA polymerase works. As I mentioned, it works like a stapler gun. Imagine this full of nucleotides, of NTPs, and DNA polymerase is taking one of each and adding to the growing strand. But after this, this is the ideal behavior of DNA polymerase, how we imagine it will work in the cell. But there are a lot of interactions in the cell, like solvent interactions, water molecules interacting with the DNA strand, or thermal fluctuations between molecules, and this is actually how it looks like. So if we're gonna study a system like this, we need to take an approach to consider all these real interactions that are happening in the cell. Can we go to the next slide? So the question of my research is how to better understand the mechanical behavior of DNA polymerase during DNA synthesis, and in particular the binding interactions. This means how we can understand better how DNA polymerase works when synthesize a new double strand. And we want to focus on the binding interactions because we can study this in terms of thermodynamic quantities, the variables. Oh, sorry, can you go back? Before this, this is an X-ray crystallography of DNA polymerase. And what we want to do is replicate this this real molecule into a model that we can simulate and put the and study with the variables that we were interested in. So how we're going to do this is using molecular simulations. And molecular simulations are theoretical models based on real-life systems. So we introduce how the theories of how molecules behave, how they interact with each other, how they look like, and we run the simulation. Basically, it's literally putting the atoms in a coordinate plane. So we set up the atoms, each one with a space and time location, and each atom calculates the forces based on the other atoms or molecules, and the simulation repeats recalculating these new interactions and these new forces. So there are different resolutions when it comes to simulations. Ideally, we will want to replicate every single atom there is in a simulation to get like the most realist behavior, but it is really expensive, to be honest. And what I mean by expensive, it is computer cost expensive. So if we're gonna replicate all atom simulations, it could only run for like nanometer sizes and for picoseconds. Picoseconds, if you have an idea, is 10 to the minus 12. And actually the process of catalyzing one DNA replication takes a millisecond. So it'll be like a trillion steps that we need to simulate, and that's just too much. So we're gonna focus on coarse grain simulations. Coarse grain simulations don't represent every single atom there is in the molecule, but groups them as group of atoms or group of molecules. And for example, here in DNA, you can see like the backbone is made up of only two subunits when in reality there are many. And it's better because it can run for more time and for bigger sizes of molecules. It's less expensive for the computer. So the methods that I'm going to use for my proposal is based on a program developed in Dr. Keller's lab by Dr. Adams, which is TM2. TM2 is a molecular simulation program, which it's a coarse grain program, which takes these units and separates them by two types, which are bead or shell units. Shell units are volume repulsive. Bead units are who account for the forces. The motion of the molecules is governed by Brownian dynamics. The solvation model is implicit. What this means is that we don't put water molecules in the model, but the interactions of the water molecules to the DNA or the DNA polymerase molecules are accounted by forces that are implicit in the solvent. And the interaction of the particles are determined by force fields that are recalculated every time. So the broad goal of my proposal is simulate the behavior of DNA polymerase, as I mentioned, synthesizing a new DNA molecule. And I want you to focus on the chart in the top right, which is a free energy diagram. And as you can see, the initial state of the DNA and the DNA polymerase is a high energy process, and it finished low. And this is what I want an attempt to do with my work. is accounting for the thermodynamic interactions, so representing this process in terms of free energy and equilibrium constant quantities. And as you can see, it's a spontaneous process because the energy drops by a significant amount. And the specifics of my proposal is developing or building the slider part of the polymerase, which is the one that binds the DNA molecule. Also, I wanted to calculate this binding strength from the slider to the DNA. The binding strength can be calculated, can be determined because if we calculate the constant of equilibrium, that gives you free energy, that gives you work, and that gives you force. And finally, I want to calculate also the energy of movement, so the free energy of how the DNA polymerase slides across the DNA molecule. And the next slide, please. And this is important because the coarse grain models for DNA molecules are not in the best state of the It's not that they're not in the best state of the art, but they haven't developed for much time. These processes are usually working for like protein molecules or other different type of models. Also, improving the understanding of synthesis of DNA is essential. It's a process that runs across all life, and it's involving as many applications as you can think. One of the popular ones is cancer, for example. And creating models that function according to free energy values, which is not an approach that is seen much in the literature, and also that can be used in other models for other people to study different things. I want to give a special thanks to Dr. Keller, which is my faculty mentor and guiding me along all this process, to Gustavo Garcia, my graduate student mentor, which was also guiding me all in the research process, and Alejandro Medio, which is the director of the program from the Puente Fellowship, and all my Puente Fellows and people part of the center, which have been really supporting this process. These are my references. Thank you.